I went to London when I was 16 years old. I marched in the New Year's Day parade in London. I played the trumpet at the time. Actually, I played the baritone. I used to play trumpet, played baritone. Wills, you'll identify with that. I played trumpet, love trumpet. I love Dizzy Gillespie. And so I had a tendency to raise the trumpet and put my head down. And my band director hated that and criticized me all the time. And he switched me to baritone. And he said it was because he thought my embouchure was more, it was better suited for baritone, which
yep, that's what I
he
got.
Was. He was exactly right, which also was like the most racist thing you could say. Yep. Like, your lips are just big enough to play this big ass horn. We gonna need your big ass lips on this big ass horn. But, you know, fortunately, even being in the South, that's not what he said to me. He said my embouchure was better suited for the baritone.
And see, that's what I got verbatim. That's what I got when I got moved from trumpet to baritone. That's what I got. We're all black men just end up on tenor and low brass because they don't want us. They don't think our lips can fit in a trumpet.
Louis Armstrong had permanently damaged lips, but could play the hell out of that trumpet. You know, I imagine so many band directors like, yo, man, we need to switch you. No. And you know how badly I want to play this? I'm going to kill all my shit. I ain't going to be able to feel nothing going through my lips. My lips are going to look like Ric Flair's forehead for the rest of my life. Because I'm going to play this trumpet. It's easier to carry this trumpet. It's easier to be, like, ladies love this trumpet. Ladies don't want to see no baritone. Like, they ain't thinking, ooh, that's a sexy-ass baritone player. No.
I've never they get a trumpet. A woman carrying a baritone.
But listen, if I see a female carrying a baritone, typically she is someone I would want to smash. But I'm saying I don't know that there are a lot of women who see dudes carrying baritones, and they say I won't smash that dude because he's carrying that baritone. That's where I have to draw a line.
Can confirm. Hey everyone, welcome to Three Card Monty. Under which screen is Wills?
Anything for
keep
the viewers.
Keep your eye on the screen.
Which one?
We're recreating Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels now. We think we're better than Guy Ritchie. That's what's happening. We're going to one-up Guy Ritchie.
Guy Ritchie never had a podcast like this. Those last 20 seconds was real fun for our people who watch this show on YouTube or Spotify. So if you're not watching the video version, the video version's available on YouTube and Spotify. Everyone, welcome to the podcast with Wills Maxwell Jr. I'm Wills Maxwell Jr. Thanking you once again for clicking play on another episode. Episode recorded. The kids are excited. They've been sitting in the studio waiting. We're just on standby.
They're not in my studio. They're in his studio, not my studio.
They are.
Everyone is of age in this motherfucker. Everybody.
Good point.
Just letting that be known. Just talking about the Epstein report being released, and then now we got this controversy. I don't know. Can't do it.
The children and their parents have been on standby, just waiting. just waiting for a chance at showbiz.
That better? I don't think that's better.
They're showbiz parents. Have you seen what showbiz parents will put their kids into?
Good point.
I get that. It still sounds like one of us at least has somebody locked up somewhere, is what I'm saying. Like, and I guess probably me, because I'm dimly lit, and these could all be bomb-making books, you know, so.
For the sake of liability, we will release that there are no parents or children held captive. MT has not committed to any crime.
That's all I'm asking for.
In this sense. Welcome to the podcast, folks. Thank you all for once again pressing play. We are back doing this, keeping it going in 2024. First recording This will be the second episode here in 2024. This is our first time recording in 2024. That means regulation has started. Let's go. Start the clock. As usual, I'm here with my friend, my coworker, my boss, the JF Kennedy of Bannerscape Media. JR Equipment is here. JR, how goes it?
What's good? What's good, man? Happy New Year, man. Happy New Year. How's your New Year going so far, bro?
It's good. It's good. I'm welcoming the new year. I don't do new year, new me anymore. I don't do that, but I do new year, slightly improved me. You know, this is my I'm just a Formula One car at the start of another season. We're coming off of we got some points last year. We didn't get a championship, but we got some points. We're not gonna throw the whole car out and start all over. We're gonna make some tweaks. Tune some things up. This is new year, new tune-up.
So yeah, so this season you're the Lewis Hamilton this season since Max Verstappen won last season. So you're Lewis Hamilton of it.
Lewis Hamilton.
He could be the greatest F1 driver of all time. You know what I mean?
But I firmly
he lost
say
last yes. season. Yeah, I mean I firmly say
legacy cemented. Even if he doesn't win another championship, like at this point, he's Michael Jordan playing for the Wizards. Like,
I'm impressed by y'all's knowledge of these. I'm just shocked that Wills came out saying that he was at the level of an F1 vehicle. Not even like NASCAR Truck Series or
North Carolina, yeah.
Or an Olympic 10-speeder. What are they ride? What are the kind of bikes that they ride in the Olympics? I mean, you came out F1, like Formula One racing.
Oh, yeah.
He didn't even say IndyCar.
No.
Okay.
Not F3, not F2. I'm 2023 was good. Just making some tweaks.
I like it.
JR, it's good to have you back. It's good to be doing this another year. We're keeping it going.
Good to see you, brother. Good to see you. Let's do it, man. Let's have some fun.
Our guest hopped in. He was ready to go. He is coming hot. He is joining us from Saddam Hussein's spider hole.
I about spit my damn water all over these computer screens. Hell no. Oh, shit.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Oh. I like where
we're at. I lost y'all for a second. Oh, God.
Yeah, we're good.
All right, cool. This name I'm about to say is no stranger to the folks in Wilmington, North Carolina. He was an MC. Now he's an MC. He'll explain that. He'll tell you the differences between the two. But he's a dope entertainer, dope comedian, dope producer. Pleasure to work with every single time. And just again, if you're in this area, if you're in this part of North Carolina, you know this name already. And if you don't, that's on you. I hate to blame people, but that's on you because he's out there working. Folks, our guest today, MT Bottles, is here. MT, how goes it, man?
That was perfect. I found another way to light myself, so we're going to test that out also. Everything is great besides this lighting. We've tried before we even got on air, we've been trying out several different versions of it. It just won't stop looking like I'm going to tell you just the most horrible Christmas camp story ever. Like, we went back to the summer camp. This is like the third or fourth sequel, and I'm the cook because or actually nowadays, like, maybe I'm the hedge fund manager who is taking over the camp because I like the property down, but that's only because the director is known to be super woke or something. Anyway, I think we have found some better lighting to give me in this regard. I'm doing well. I'm happy to be here.
Genuinely, I like the look right now. I like Thank the lighting you. That you've got going. This is our maybe 10th, 11th video episode. And this is my first time I figured out how to get my lighting right because I have looked ashy for the last 10 episodes, and it has horrified me that you wouldn't believe the amount of just Eucerin I slather on my arms before we start recording an episode, and the lighting has just been harsh.
Hey, and that shit's thick, too, though. That Eucerin is thick. You got to get it in there. You got to rub it.
You got to... If you're not already just like a little moist to begin with, it's no go. It's a no go.
I think you're being brave if you're being able to show your elbows right now. Y'all can't see my elbows, so I'm banking on that right now.
Oh, sleeves, bro. I ain't sleeping. It's too cold outside. And my dumb ass, I wore shorts today. You know what I mean? Just because when I left the house, it was 50, 55 degrees, feeling good. You know, wasn't thinking, oh, it might get down in the 20s. You know what I mean? Real. So legs are ashy as hell right now.
I dig it.
I shouldn't have told everybody that. But, you know, it's the pocket.
Now all I can wonder about is if you got pants on or not. So
I've thrown you this lifeline several times in the interest of you keeping your job. Can you say on the recording, on this, going into our third year of doing this broadcast together, can you say on the record that when you are at work in a professional capacity, surrounded by your coworkers and your employers, that you, a professional human being at your job, do in fact wear pants?
I plead the fifth.
Okay. All right.
The fifth.
I tried.
How many fingers am I holding up? 1, 2, 3, 4. There are so many amendments in the Constitution, but my favorite one is the fifth.
All right, I threw that softball. All right, our guest today, MT. I'm so happy to see you, bro.
No, same here.
I'm so happy to have you on. This is so I said you were an MC, and now you're an MC. Mostly because I kind of want first question: MT Bottles. Where did the name MT Bottles come from? What does that mean?
In a previous life in this universe, I was a rapper or an aspiring rapper called Major Travesty, which the more and more I think about it, my real name, first name is Travis. That's just way too simple of a rap name, but, you know, it sounded devastating. But then when you spell that out and you keep the I, it really looks silly.
But then I felt, so you kept I the felt I, weird. So it was...
Yeah, it looked so weak. That wasn't the reason I quit rap. I just, you know, wasn't as good as most people. So, but that was my name, was Major Travesty. The last performance I did rap-wise was right literally at the beginning of COVID, and someone asked me how I wanted to be billed because I hadn't really done music in a while. And I said MT Bottles. I thought it was catchy. It was the MT. And I did used to drink a lot. I used to party a lot. And so I was like, fuck it, that's what I'll be known as. That's, you know, whatever. And so it kind of morphed into, I started hosting trivia online during COVID, during the pandemic, when everybody was at home. And I was doing games like Facebook Live. And then, you know, actually people started hiring me to do private games via Zoom. And there was a while I was hosting like 8 trivia games a week. I was making, you know, $1,100 a week eating off that during the pandemic.
Oh, sure.
And
yeah.
So anyway, I did all of that, got to the reopening of things, and in doing so, someone saw me and they thought I was pretty good, hired me live in a restaurant and a bar, and that morphed into being at a game one night. Someone thought I was funny. And they were like, you should do stand-up. And they convinced me to do an open mic at the local comedy club. 2 months later, someone saw me, thought I'd be good on a paid gig. I did a paid gig. And then I felt really good. I was like, if I can do 30 of these in a year, I feel like I'm doing something, like I'm on the right track. And I ended up doing 75 gigs my first year.
Wow.
And that was it. I was like, I'm supposed to be doing this. So here I am.
That's amazing, man. Yeah. I love that. Yeah, that is incredible.
Yeah.
How that is such a circuitous route to getting to stand-up comedy, the thing that I mostly know you for now that you've been doing for the past few years. That's really incredible. Like, just your presence and your, you know, background of an entertainer brought you here, led you to that.
Yeah.
Do you still rap?
Because we've got
a beat we're gonna drop right now. I'm talking.
Because I mean, you don't want these bars. That's all.
If I have to rap my way out of a situation, I could do it. It's funny, I drove where I am now is 4 hours away from Wilmington. I'm in central North Carolina, and I drove up literally an hour before we started, on this cast. And so there were a couple of songs where I have a playlist called Riding Slow, and it's mostly like older Texas rap, some Atlanta raps, and just real deep gutter, just boom. And mixed in with that is just a tiny little bit of, it's like one Biggie song and the Jay-Z song Feeling It, which is one of my favorite of all time. Also, Where I'm From, which is Marcy, son, ain't nothing. Not, anyway, it's all in this playlist, and that's my, like, when I'm trying to get my mind in the right place. So there were some songs I started flowing to a little bit, and unfortunately, I could hear myself, and I'm like, oh, a little rusty. But if I had to settle a hostage situation with a 30-second freestyle right now, I could do it and get it done and get everybody free.
Oh, hell yeah.
MT, do you mind if we put you on the spot? Just because, do you mind if I set the scene for that scenario?
Why would I? You have put me up as a premier entertainer. Obviously, I'm going to deliver. So whatever you got.
Okay. All right. So we're all at the comedy club. You're on stage. You're crushing it. We're having a good time. And then you say a joke that offends somebody. You talk about going to a Pizza Hut, and a Domino's employee stands up and says, "I'm not having that." And he pulls a gun out and he goes, "I'm going to keep everybody in this club. And I'm gonna off one person every 30 seconds. It's a lot. It's really quick. Unless in these next 30 seconds, somebody can hit a freestyle that moves me. A Domino's employee offended at a comedy club. Unless someone has a 30-second freestyle that can touch my heart and soul, everyone here is getting held hostage."
It's very clear that it's my time to shine. I have to make sure that I go line by line. If I didn't know any better, I would think that you may have written letters to try to avoid the noise. I don't know if it really takes you back that far to understand what you've been told, but right now I'm gonna make sure that you understand you've been sold a bag of lies if you ever thought you were said to not have someone who could deliver these lies. I mean, these rhymes. I mean, these are the times that we have to make sure we understand what we're doing, because it's just me. I'm gonna put you in ruins. I just need you to know that everybody's leaving. Pepperoni is sausage. They all gonna be cheesing. Cause when we get outside, we gonna be ourselves. And all I know is that I'm Santa, they're elves. We all run around in circles, making sure everything gets done. Because if we don't get home, I'm gonna need that gun. And I don't think you really want me to use it. It's gonna be you that's gonna end up abused. And I don't know if I have to go to jail, but all I know is that it's me writing you mail. Commentary, I don't think so. Commentary, I don't need it. Bo, that's what we call you in the country instead of bruh. Bo, you better get a bowl because you're going to need to smoke one up. Take it tough. We done. 30 seconds has passed, and I realize now it's just all first class.
Bro! Yes, sir!
Damn. Damn, yeah.
Listen, Balls. You said a pizza employee in a comedy. You naming off some of my favorite nearest and dearest things. I'm making sure we all going home safely. I'm going to get that done.
He said avoid the noise. He put that gun down at that line. I want to tell you. He lowered the gun to his side.
That did it.
It was just feeling. It was just that meme of JC with his glasses on. Where he's just, that's what he was doing that whole time. Just not into it.
I just watched the Matt Damon Bourne trilogy the other day. Like, I've already visualized this process scenario. I'm there.
I think I do think about that so often. It's like, what would I do in a hostage scenario? And my conclusion is I would die immediately doing something stupid. That is my conclusion. I'll think about that sometime just walking around. It's like, what if someone pops around a corner right now? It's like, okay, well, I would jab step to the right, go to the left, try to hook his arm. I was like, I have zero training. It's just mankind.
I'm gonna get in trouble for this, but I'm gonna tell you anyway. So, my father died when I was 9. Okay, so my mother dated different men. And when you're from a small town, everybody knows each other, right? So, and your dating pool, I've learned from being single as an adult, is incredibly small in a small town. So, everybody knows everybody. And so, but this story is too good to pass up. She dated a man for a while who was very interesting guy. He was smart, was articulate, but while being well-spoken, he spoke very slowly and a lot of times seemed to be very thoughtful in his words, which is great for anyone. You want a human being to be thoughtful and have purpose behind whatever they say to you in any moment or any interaction. But he spoke so slowly and so thoughtful that my sister and I used to make a joke that there may come a time when there's some kind of situation where the next person who says anything is going to get a bullet. And it would take him so long to process that thought that he'd be like, well, and then bang, he's dead. That's what that made me think of. I also realize now I'm really in trouble for this. This is going to be interesting. I hope none of my family watch any of this. They haven't watched any of my comedy yet, so I don't know why they would start with this podcast. So
for some reason, this is the podcast where families decide to tune in. We've had people be like, my dad listened to this episode and he heard me say gross. I don't know.
I wish I knew that before I told that story. Now,
Just don't share the link.
Do share the link, but don't share it to your family. Don't share it.
Yeah. For some reason,
I like all of that, actually.
This is when families decide they're going to tune in. They're just like, 12 minutes at a comedy club. No, but they're going to talk for an hour. I can listen to that in the car. This is when they tune in. And thank you.
thank you so very much. Subscribe, share with your friends, with anybody.
If for any other reason to know what happens to any of us in the future, especially me after I get murdered by a family member for telling the story. So.
I think half of our audience is parents of former guests. I think our audience is people like, well, my kid was on this one time and you know what? I'm going to keep doing it. Like, and thank you. MT, I know how we reacted and everything, but I just want to make sure I give you enough props for coming on this, not expecting to freestyle tonight, not expecting to like be put on the spot. I wasn't expecting to do that to you, but that was incredible. Like you really embraced the bizarre scenario.
If I'm being honest with you, I had no idea what to expect. As a matter of fact, so just to let everyone know a little thing, I got the information to be on here less than 24 hours ago. And I didn't know if I was like a second choice or why I got chosen because
Will's, that's how he rolls. I'm a co-host with him. Well, I'm not a co-host. No, I'm not a co-host. I'm just.
Yeah, you're a co-host. What are you talking about? Journey. This is year three. You're the co-host.
Okay, whatever. Anyway, whatever. I get a text message it was probably 1:30 that if I'm okay to record tonight.
Okay, but it's on his calendar.
It's on your calendar. I'm just making sure.
I thought to myself.
MT got a text message last night, which is honestly earlier than 80% of our guests.
Yeah.
I didn't know if that was part of the process, and now I'm even more flattered.
That's what I was about to say. You should be flattered.
Okay. Let me tell you, I'm even more flattered because Will's is somewhat of a comedy hero to me. when I moved to Wilmington in 2011, Wills was the first comedian that I saw do comedy in Wilmington. As a matter of fact, really before that, I had not seen a lot of live comedy. And so when I got down here, Wills was one of the first people I saw. When Wills is introduced, he's wearing like this oversized shirt. He's got a tie on. And I have terrible eyesight. And so I wore glasses, really thick, big ass glasses for a long time. And when I saw Wills, I saw myself and I was like, I don't know if myself's going to be very funny. And Wills got up there and was hilarious. And I've loved comedy since I was a kid. I never thought I'd perform it, but I've loved watching comedy since I was very young. Love Richard Pryor, love Eddie Murphy, love Don Rickles, Stephen Wright. Like, these are some of the people that I really, you know, have tried to do proud, so to speak. But I'd never really seen me get on stage before until I saw Wills. And Wills was so, so good. And so ever since, I've always loved going to see Wills. And now it's such a trip to be like, yo, you want to be on my podcast tomorrow? I will drive up I-40 like a bat out of hell just to make sure I make it on this podcast tonight. So I am incredibly honored to know that I was not even a second choice. That's just like, you know what? I want to have MT on the podcast. MT, can you do the podcast? Like, that's lovely to me. So thank you, Wills. Thank you very, very much for having me.
Of course. Thank you. That's very kind of you, for real.
I was about to try to make some stupid ass joke about you still wanted to do comedy after seeing that shit on stage. But after you said that beautiful statement, I couldn't even bring myself to do it.
Thank you. Thank you for not doing it, I guess. I feel like this is you not doing it.
No, after hearing that, I wouldn't say that. How the hell did he still want to do comedy after hearing that shit on stage? I've heard him at Thalian Hall in front of 50 to 100 old Greek white people. And I tell you what, that did not make me want to do comedy. Not because he wasn't fucking hilarious, just because that mirror that he was holding up to those old Greek white people about the world we live in was not sitting well with them. But three other black people in there, it was the shit.
It was not what they came to a centuries-old building built by slaves to hear that night. It was not what they were.
You don't want to hear about redlining in that environment. That's
right, yeah. Getting a complete silence on a redlining joke in City Hall is
I mean, that shit was great.
No, I thank God for Cliff's show, because that just, like, to be on the same stage and tell the same jokes and get the complete polar reaction from more people was
awesome.
That's healing, because but no, MT, for real, thank you for saying that. Yeah. You were first choice for this episode, and I am honored that you see me in something like that, just because you're dope, man. You have a presence when you get on stage. You're hilarious, and like, you're good at this. I didn't even realize that you were only 2 to 3 years into comedy. I was assuming you'd been doing it longer, because you are comfortable on stage. Like, you talk and act like a pro, and the shows you produce are fire. So you were nice enough to have me at Johnny Luke's. You were doing the supper club at Johnny Luke's, and the shows you produce are fun. You've had me there, and you've had me at Cheesesteak. Can you tell us a little bit about the shows you have going on, the shows you produce?
Yeah. Well, first off, I don't know that people really understand how much I love to hear myself talk. I don't know why. This is the reaction I get from most people. I could not be more honest. I love hearing me talk. And so being able to do that and make money, this is literally a dream come true. When they say speaking into existence, like, I speak my rent into existence 3 to 4 times a week. I love producing. I love being on the microphone. And so producing gives me the ability to do it. And then the other thing that producing allows me to do is I get to have other people pay money to bring my favorite comedians to sit and to do jokes right in front of me. That's the best thing in the world. I get to have other people pay me to bring my favorite comedians to wherever I happen to be on a Saturday night. That's a lot of fun. And then the Johnny Lukes thing, I get to put spaghetti in front of people or me. And so I get pasta and my favorite comedian. Like, there's not much better than that. Having a daughter, yeah, whatever. But, you know, everything else pales in comparison. And so I love producing. I do the Johnny Lukes show, which is dinner and a show. It's got the bar, you get the drink and do all that. I have a new show that's coming next month being February, to a new venue in Wilmington called Ellipsis, where they are a venue. They do themed experiences. Every night is something different. They have some recurring events, and I'm starting one called Funny Bites. So it's small plates, like, you know, tapas styled dishes, and then with each course, with each dish, we have a different comedian. And this is, you know, a little more high caliber than just a typical bar show, because it's incredibly intimate. It's a very small room. The plates are small, but we're looking for big laughs. And so I'm excited to do this because I like being comfy. I'm a big dude and I like food and I like to laugh. I like to have a good time. And so that's why I like doing these kind of shows where I want people to feel what my ultimate experience is. And that's like, the only thing that make it better is if I'm gonna do a PJ version of this, like a pajama version. And Matt's gonna be really cool, but
hell yeah.
I probably won't be able to do that in North Carolina with our current supermajority legislature that we have that's incredibly gerrymandered and really needs to be changed. That probably won't take place here. It'll be somewhere that's a little more accepting, because I'm not saying things are gonna get super freaky or anything like that. I'm just saying I want people to feel comfortable enough where if a titty came out at dinner, that's okay. A titty can always be put back. A titty can always go away if it needs to go away. But I want people to understand we can be at a meal, and if a titty come out, it's okay. And we all laugh about it or do other things. But anyway, that's what my ultimate goal is. But for now, I'm left with where we are, and I'm enjoying that part. Food and jokes. So I'm enjoying that.
Hell yeah. And I feel like a broken record because I feel like I ask this question to damn near everybody that we bring on the show. I'm truly fascinated by it and the process that you guys go through to get on stage and everything and let out the project that you all been putting so much work in behind the scenes, letting that all out in front of people. So with that, which part of it do you enjoy the most, making, writing the jokes or writing the shows or performing?
Man, that's what a question. What a great question.
I ask you that. I feel it's crazy because really I feel like I ask everybody that, but
you have to.
It's fascinating. It's
absolutely have to. Because I for me, so I'm a process guy, period. Like, I love the process. I love to know and understand why something becomes the final product that it becomes, whatever that case may be. Like, we were just in Disney World, and I love thinking about when I'm on rides in Disney World, I've lost the ability to be amazed by just simply the show. I'm thinking about on Small World what they do to fix anything that's in the animatronics. Like, if an eye is wandering, it's not blinking the right way, I'm thinking about what they may have, do they have to shut down the whole ride? Is that something that's electronic? Like, I love details. And so in writing, I do love the writing, but the problem with, and this is the difference between, for me at least, writing music and writing comedy. Writing music, I always enjoyed the poetry. In comedy, when I write, I'm trying to fight against the want to know if I'm funny right then. It's such a struggle writing and trying to write funny, and instead of writing to be free. And if it just so happens that you're funny when you're free, I think that is where the art is. And so I am constantly searching for that instead of trying to write to be funny. And all of that means it's that much more of a detailed process, which makes me fall in love with it that much more. But man, I told you, I love hearing myself talk. When I get to perform, you give me a microphone and speakers, I can hear myself.
Right, yeah.
All bets are off. And then people are into it. And people don't, they don't get up, they don't leave. Like, they don't. Yeah. So thank you for asking that question, because my. Yeah.
That's awesome. You mentioned your daughter. So what has that been like for you in each form, like just being a parent in show business and entertainment? How's that balance been?
And how old is she first? How old is she first?
She just turned 7.
Oh, wow. She
turned 7. And she is the absolute motivation for me to do well and do well performance wise and to be good at the business part. Because that's the reason, I mean, she is the reason why, you know, I wake up and do anything. Right. I have to be honest, I always wanted kids ever since I can remember. I always wanted a family. And I wanted to be married and have children. And I did both. And so far, one of them seemingly successfully, at least so far. And so she, having her in my life and being an entertainer is the hardest possible thing I can think of doing right now. But it also is just, it's the absolute best. We were able to do that Disney trip. We did a Christmas Florida trip where we went to Disney World and Orlando Magic Game and all this stuff. And amazing. We did it, and we were able to do it because of what I do. And that's amazing. I posted something when I first started in comedy. I posted a story, and it was a set of pictures of me being, I had my webcam on and my ring light. And everybody's putting up the posters like, I bet I can't get this many likes or whatever. And so I did this, a series of my own. I'd never done it before. I always thought they were foolish, but I wanted, you know, I thought maybe this is what I needed to do starting out in comedy. So I put this series of things up, and it basically said, I bet I can't get 30 bookings in, comedy clubs across America to feed my family and take my daughter to Disney World. I put that in that story on social media at that time. And that was really what I wanted to do, because she loved Disney. She had been to Disney World and wanted to go with me. And so I was able to do that because of comedy. And it's now I think about, what else can I do? But it's hard. It's really hard. I have so much material that involves her. And then I have to remember, the internet keeps everything. So how is she going to feel in a few years? There's so much to, and then like the hours, paying for childcare as a single dad doing this, you know, how's it balanced with me paying other bills? Like, am I working just to pay for her childcare? I'm trying to work to, you know, have us do anything we want. So there's a lot of things. Priorities are massively key in that process. But I will tell you this quickly, on this trip, she and I have a very special bond, and we make it a point to be able to tell each other anything. And she has an incredible memory. She's 7, but she said to me, we'd just gone to see Wonka. This was on Thursday night before the Friday where we're going to do this all day Disney extravaganza. But we had gone to see Wonka. We were driving back to the hotel, and she says, Daddy, why were you crying that time I was sitting in your lap? And it threw me, because that had not happened anytime recently, and I couldn't remember a time when it happened. And I said, baby, what are you talking about? She said, I think I was maybe 3. And I'm like, how does she where is this coming from? And she said, I was sitting in your lap and you were crying. And I had a memory flash where I had a memory flash up in my brain where I was really having a hard time. It was after her mother and I had broken up, and I was really struggling financially. And I think I just kind of broke down with her one day. I don't remember why, what the catalyst was, but I know it was during that time. And in the drive, I said, well, baby, you know, things were kind of hard for a while for me because I wanted the best for you. And I told her my reasoning, and we both end up crying in the car. But she, as we're kind of sobbing, again, we're driving through Florida back from this movie, which Florida has the worst drivers in all of the world. I have not been to the Punjab province, but I have to imagine people who drive Nissan Altimas from Florida, they're going to give anybody a run for their money in the Punjab province. And I don't even care if it's in like Eastern Russia, Vladivostok, okay? They got nothing on Orlando, Florida, Nissan Altima driver. So I'm sitting there bawling my eyes out. My daughter is comforting me from the back seat, rubbing my arm while she's sobbing, and I am dodging Florida men everywhere. It was emotional and probably one of the most frightening nights of my entire life. You know, the only thing that would have made that better is if I guess I could have made sure that I put some type of Confederate symbol on my car to make sure that we would have been completely left alone.
You're doing good.
You know, loud trucks just blasting past me, you know, but here we are having this emotional Tyler Perry approved moment, and it was beautiful. And then we go to Disney World the next day, and I'm sitting on a small world thinking, wow, I need to make more money. We got to be up here, you know, so.
Yeah.
Anyway,
MT, that's a beautiful story.
That's beautiful.
Thank you for sharing that. That's beautiful. While you were in Orlando, did you and your daughter get a chance to go visit Machine Gun America?
We did not. However, we did not get to go see Machine Gun America.
For our folks, this is my wife and I, we went to Orlando. She had a work thing, so we were like in Orlando for a week, and we were like, okay, what's there to do in Orlando? So she pulled up a list. Number one is Disney World. Number two is Universal Studios. Number three on things to do in Orlando, a high ranking, is Machine Gun America, a theme park with the promise that you get to fire a real machine gun.
Wow.
Well, you know, it's funny you asked me that because I knew going to Florida was going to be, you know, it could be a thing, reasons. But I was hopeful. And so on the way down, actually right outside of Orlando, we stopped at the Daytona Buc-ee's. And we love Buc-ee's. Anywhere we are traveling and there's a Buc-ee's available to get to, we get to it. This particular one, now mind you, this is holiday travel, so there are a lot of people, a lot of different types of people, and we happen to be at one where the type of person that was there was one that smokes a cigarette at the gas pump. You know, I'm not saying they were from Alabama. But this is Alabama type of person.
Alabama-ish.
Yeah, like a Florida. They would actually, this is a person Florabama. Who identifies as a Florabamian. And unapologetically smoking a very long cigarette by a gas pump while fueling her vehicle. So anyway, as we pull in, that was setting the scene. We pull in, and we park next to a truck that a person was in the passenger seat. We go into Buc-ee's, we pick up a couple of things, come back out. My car, I drive an older vehicle, which is very reliable, but it does not have, I don't have a key fob. I have to unlock my door with the key, which means it may take me a moment to get my vehicle and also to unlock the door, get my daughter in the vehicle. Well, the person who's in this truck is now two people in this truck. Next means a very large truck. It's very loud, and it's, you know, like a 5'8 guy getting into a very high step. Anyway, you get the picture. As he gets in his truck, he's in there a lot faster, and I'm in my car, and he's getting upset that he has to wait to move his vehicle. So he guns it out, and I got to make sure I'm not getting hit. As I get into my car, I say to my daughter, I'm like, man, you know, he could have waited. And she said, he was pretty rude, huh? I said, yeah, he was pretty rude. And she says, yeah, he's a bad guy, huh? And I said, well, I mean, I don't know if he's a bad guy. He might be a bad guy. She said, yeah, you know, I kill bad guys. And that was hard, because I didn't know what was happening in that moment. But then this is where that parent thing kicks in. She says that because she loves spy things. She loves Casey Undercover.
Oh, sure.
Zendaya isn't. Yeah, she loves Casey Undercover. So I had to remind her, Zendaya doesn't kill anybody in that show. Sometimes she knocks them out or whatever. And then my daughter says, but you have to kill bad guys, right? I'm like, well, you know, if they're really bad, like, you know, maybe. And now we're getting into a super deep conversation with a 7-year-old.
It's you and a 7-year-old having the Daredevil Punisher rooftop conversation.
In buckets. In the buckets.
And your daughter is the Punisher.
She's eating pink rock candy from Bucky's. We just bought a Bucky's coloring book. And she's talking something about, and you know what I really believe? I think it's something in that, what is that animal? Is it a squirrel? Is it a chip? Whatever the fuck it is. I think something about, it's so visceral, it just triggers her. Them teeth, because it's a real simple picture of a cartoon character, but those teeth are just, rawr, you know, they're right there. And it's something that triggers her. That, and after all this happened, we're driving away. We've gotten out to Winter Park, Florida. Our hotel that we're staying in is in North Orlando. So it's right near, we're in Winter Park, and we're driving through a golf course. Literally, because it's a road that goes to the middle of the golf course. And she said, Daddy, are you heavy? Are you a heavy guy? And I said, well, yeah, I guess I can be considered a little heavy. And she said, you know what's heavy? And I said, what, baby? And she said, killing a bad guy. My daughter, I don't know. It's a lot going on. Having a daughter like this and doing comedy,
wow,
it's so much.
you've got some Batman speeches to play for her or something. When you kill a killer, there's now the killer stays the same. Like, you got some,
no coming,
you,
there's no coming back.
There's no coming back.
You got some, never speeches. The same person yet.
Well, and she loves Spider-Man. She loves the Tom Holland Spider-Man.
Again,
and she's watched. She will. She refuses to watch Far From Home. I don't know what it is about Mysterio. She refuses to watch Far From Home, but she loves Homecoming and No Way Home. And she loves those movies. But in No Way Home, when Aunt May dies, she had so many questions about that, and Green Goblin, and like why, and it just, there was so much. And so now it's so interesting to kind of see how this is now coming back out in her brain, and how she feels about bad guys. And it's
because she was rooting for Tom Holland to just drive that glider down. She, Toby McGuire jumps in front of the glider and stops him, and she's like, what are you?
She has some serious moral absolutes, but even in the same, like, she doesn't like for me to kill a bug. She wants me to get the bug and take it outside.
Bug's not a bad guy.
Yeah, she loves animals. She's, you know, so it's really nice to know that your daughter, that's what, sociopath or psychopath? I mean, it's so glad to see that she's not a psychopath.
She's on some path. She's not a psychopath, yeah. She's not psychopath or sociopath. She's on hero path. She's on vigilante
path. Yeah, exactly.
Vigilante path. Vigilante.
Potentially.
I mean, she's doing some good, though. I mean, doing it for the, you know.
I like where she's in the service of her country, perhaps.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Brother, yeah. I am so grateful to you for coming on today. This has been so much fun talking with you. I earnestly can hear your stories for like another like just day. So we need to have you back. I can
tell them for a day.
Because I know you've got more stories. I know you've got more that you do that we didn't get into. So we really need to have you back. Until we have you back, where can the people find you?
I still host trivia, and I still have a good time doing it, again, because I have a microphone. I'm Tuesday nights, I'm at Seagate Bottle Shop in Wilmington. Wednesday nights, I'm at Dramtree Tavern in Wilmington, both times, 7 p.m., Tuesdays and Wednesdays, come play trivia with me. Comedy-wise, you can see me monthly at Dramtree Tavern. We do a showcase there. Like I said, we've got Funny Bites coming to Ellipsis in Wilmington. Those tickets are on sale at ellipsisilm.com. And always check me out on Instagram, social media. I'm all over Instagram. I'm Empty Bottles Comedy, Empty Bottles Trivia, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube. I may still have a MySpace account, but don't look for that one. That's another story. Yeah.
Look my dude up, Empty Bottles. He's working, he's busy, and he's motivated. And importantly, he's funny. This is a funny show. If you go catch my dude doing trivia or stand-up, go check him out. JR, what is going on in the world of Bannerscape Media?
We got In the Front Row with Mike Vaccaro. Check that out. We got a new episode popping out this week. Got a couple shows joining the network coming up here in a few weeks. So nice. We started Monsterpology last year. We had one episode, but James had some difficulties. He had to travel out west for a little while and was doing some things. But, Monsterpology's coming back in a couple more. We'll be joining the network. So
all right.
So yeah, big things popping. Check us out, man.
Cool.
Check out Monsterpology. Check out In the Front Row with Mike Vaccaro. Support all things JR. Support all things Bannerscape Media.
What folks, you got going on, Will? What you got?
Everything I do is at willsmaxwell.com. Check out willsmaxwell.com for episodes of the podcast. Late Fear, What Did We Miss? January 19th, I will be in Holly Springs at the Holly Springs Cultural Center. They're headlining a show. Jordan Century, former guest and Black Power Ranger, will be opening for me. So come check us out. And if you're in the Triangle and you keep texting me, when are you going to be back in the Triangle? This is when I'll be just outside the Triangle.
Outside the Triangle. Yeah. Might see a Confederate flag or two.
Yeah. If it's at the town center, I'm not going on stage. if I show up, I'll just be like, look, here's y'all's money back. Look, it'll be that scene from Ray where the crowd is all segregated outside. That'll be me. It's just like, why are we? Let's go home. Let's go.
Pack it up.
Oh, Jesus.
Thank you so much for checking us out, hanging out with us, and listening to the podcast. And as we say at the end of every episode,
every single one,
if you're black, you ain't allowed to play that trumpet. That's not, that trumpet is not for you. Bye, folks.